Hello, and welcome to, or welcome back to, Project Apollo, my series on a cattle seed world. Seedworlds are speculative evolution projects where a planet is seeded with Earth life, which is then left to evolve and diversify in this new context. On planet Apollo, these lifeforms were cattle, which, along with some plants and invertebrates, were left to fill every niche on the planet. In this episode, we'll be exploring herbivorous and carnivorous cows of Apollo's prairies, and how they interact and compete, eventually spiraling into a predator-prey arms race. Before we continue, I'd like to remind you to like the video and consider subscribing. It's free, helps out a bunch, and you can always change your mind. Leave a comment if you have any thoughts, and stick around to the end to see the names for several groups of cattle from the last episode, some of which were picked from the comments. Also, sorry it's been so long since the last video. It's probably mostly procrastination, if I'm being honest. Thanks for sticking with the series. Also, there will be air conditioning noise in the background for about the next minute. Sorry about that. Anyway, let's get back to the video. A predator-prey arms race is a simplified term used to describe the mutual evolution of predator and prey, with the real arms race referring to the increase of one competitor's armaments, resulting in the other competitor's armaments increasing in response. Animals are usually evolutionarily driven to avoid being eaten, resulting in defenses being evolved, and predators responding with increasingly dramatic adaptations to bypass these defenses, spiraling into dramatic measures for both species. An example of this might be modern pronghorns, which can run at about 60 miles per hour due to predation from the now extinct American cheetah. But it would take time for a predator-prey arms race to develop on Apollo. If you've been watching the series, you know the drill by now. Cattle were the only vertebrates introduced. Without predators, all that hindered their numbers was competition for resources, with the massive population soon constantly teetering on the edge of starvation. This competitive environment prompted cattle to evolve ways to fight for grass, survive on less, or make use of new food sources. One group of cattle adapted to scavenge corpses, which developed into carnivory. It was these predators that partially alleviated the overpopulation, with competition among Apollo's herbivores becoming more about being harder to eat than your rivals, rather than direct fighting for food. This especially compounded upon the appearance of Minophilus, a carnivore with jaws capable of delivering killing bites. Their arrival began an arms race between predator and prey, with herbivores evolving new ways to avoid being eaten and predators developing strategies to turn them into steak. An obvious defense, and perhaps one of the earliest to appear, would be the reemergence of herding behaviors. With the planet-wide food supply of early Apollo, these herds could grow truly massive,
perhaps numbering in the millions as they migrate around the planet. There would likely be a huge population of medium-sized herding cattle, perhaps the most visually similar to the seeded species, making up an ecological middle ground of efficiency and specialization, and filling the same niche as many ungulates of Earth. To make their herding more effective, they could behave like the notoriously aggressive Cape Buffalo of Africa, targeting predators and mobbing them. On the other hand, perhaps self-sabotage would stop such a numerous species from utilizing this strategy to its fullest, with less aggressive individuals sticking to the back and avoiding threats by being lazy, thus surviving more often to the detriment of the herd's health. In response to herding, many carnivores could become pack hunters. With the size of Apollo's herd, some cattle are bound to get separated, and a coordinated pack could intentionally cut some individuals off. This would be harder to apply to more heavily built, aggressive species, but lightly built species that flee rather than fight could be easy to separate. For the herds that do fight, stragglers might be a target. Perhaps young calves or elderly individuals could be corralled and picked off. Cape buffalo on Earth are extremely dangerous, but are a common prey for lions, especially large males. To coordinate successful hunts, these Minophilus would have to be intelligent and social, perhaps the most intelligent cattle on the planet for a time. This lifestyle could also lead to yet more similarities to big cats like lions. I wonder if Asterionoides might also benefit from working in a pack. If charging with horns makes them somewhat analogous to a bullet, then pack hunting would give them multiple shots. Apollo's herds, like on Earth, are probably going to have to cross rivers while migrating, assuming Apollo's system of multiple oceans doesn't somehow create a clear path around the planet. When cattle cross these rivers, they'll be vulnerable to aquatic predators, perhaps leading to a species of essentially bovine crocodiles. Fighting as a herd won't be much of an option when predators from below are trying to drown them. Unlike crocodiles, these cattle would need to eat regularly due to being warm-blooded. Thus, when migrating cattle aren't present, they might need to hunt other aquatic cattle, or large aquatic invertebrates once they evolve, gathering whenever herds are migrating across large rivers. Medium-sized cattle wouldn't fully dominate the planet. Predators breed competition to avoid said predators, with species eking out a niche merely by being harder to hunt than other species. Species would also deviate from the norm due to utilizing different food sources, such as different types of plants. With time, some cattle might evolve into megafaunal grazers for more efficient digestion and safety from most predators, proving extremely difficult to hunt. Of course, giant carnivores might also evolve, leading to an era of megafauna reminiscent of the dinosaurs. Although cattle obviously can't get that that big with so little time. Megafauna populations might increase upon the appearance of trees, with browsers carving out a massive niche. This could lead to species of giraffe or elephant-like cattle, eating leaves with long necks or pushing down trees, and then the trees becoming nutrient-poor in response, leading the browser populations to shrink or specialize in the tree's more nutritious bits, or perhaps specializing for digesting large amounts of nutrient-poor leaves, likely becoming bulky and lethargic. The cattle of Apollo would be likely to have a wide range of sizes, similar to the diversity found in places like the savannas of Africa. While the largest cattle would likely be safe as adults, juveniles and comparatively smaller individuals would be a food source worth exploiting. As such, tyrannotaurids and other big minnowphilids might adapt for taking down megafauna. The largest terrestrial mammalian carnivores on Earth were creatures like Andrewsarchus or the short-faced bear, with the short-faced bear standing at a height of about 11 feet on its back legs, and Andrewsarchus estimated to be 12 feet long and 6 feet high on all fours. With Apollo's lack of geographical barriers, tyrannotaurids would have a larger food supply than either of these predators. A few million years after the evolution of trees, Apollo might have a relatively stable environment for millions of years, creating conditions where a massive apex predator can hold a stable niche hunting megafauna. The short-faced bear might have gotten so large thanks to its short face, giving it a stronger bite force to crunch through the bones of the large bison, ground sloths, and other megafaunal prey of ancient North America. I initially thought Tyrannotaurus wouldn't be able to bite through bone. Cattle have no upper incisors, replaced by a soft dental pad. To bite prey effectively, Minophilus shortened its jaws, moving its upper molars forward to act as incisors. So, perhaps these shortened jaws could lead to a stronger bite force, applying pressure to a smaller area. There was also an extinct marsupial called Thylacoleo, which dominated ancient Australia and had an awesome bite force despite recently evolving from wombat-like herbivores. Perhaps Tyrannotaurus could break through bone after all, and feed similarly to a short-faced bear. Whatever the case, with a planet-wide food supply, Tyrannotaurus could get massive, depending on whether it could take down the largest megafauna. If they can't bite through bone, their kills would be valuable to scavengers, providing a meal for smaller predators who have developed a stronger bite force, which might create competition later on as these scavengers become rivals to Tyrannotaurus. Predator and prey isn't some hard-set classification in nature. Many animals that eat other animals are in turn eaten by animals higher in the food web, or of a higher trophic level. Additionally, after animals die, they become food for scavengers. While the majority of waste and corpses of cattle might be consumed by insects, some cattle might evolve into scavengers with a similar niche to vultures. This could also serve as a path into carnivory, with scavenging dead animals eventually supplemented by active hunting. They'd likely have shorter fur around their necks to avoid rotten meat getting stuck in it, and a strong sense of smell for finding food. Another common defense strategy in nature is being fast. Some herbivores might start adapting to run swiftly for long periods of time, perhaps resembling antelopes or horses. This could mean longer legs and thinner builds, likely reducing their horns to shave off weight. They might not lose them completely, as evidenced by animals like pronghorns, the fastest real-world ungulate. This build may be less efficient for digesting large quantities of grass, but the benefit of being able to outrun predators would be worth it. Of course, pursuit hunting carnivores would evolve in response, with increased endurance and eventually increased speed as predator and prey begin the evolutionary arms race of outpacing each other. These species would be lightly built, with flexible spines and long legs for chasing down prey. They might also develop longer, thicker tails to help with the fast-paced, precise turns required to catch nimble prey. I depicted them here as resembling cheetahs, but I'm not sure whether the bovine body plan can or would evolve that way, even with convergent evolution. It'd probably take a while at least. Anyway, ancient North America had some massive cheetahs, which stood taller than lions or tigers thanks to their longer legs. And like I keep repeating, Apollo's planet-wide range could lead to some speed-oriented cattle getting huge. Apollo was initially terraformed to be a massive grassland or prairie. After humans abandoned the planet, however, the system may start to decay. The relative lack of plankton and trees could result in greenhouse gases warming the planet, although the evolution of tree-like plants would improve the situation after some time. Still, some cattle might specialize for hotter zones of the planet, with thinner bodies and large flaps of droopy skin filled with circulating blood to keep cool. Ears might be perfect for this role. This environmental instability could potentially lead to colder regions as well, with cattle developing bulkier bodies to retain heat and thick coats of fur. Another biome mentioned a lot in the comments is mountainous regions, but I'm imagining Apollo is currently being rather flat. However, if any orogeny, or mountain building, does occur, some cattle might get small to be more nimble and develop their hooves into something used for climbing, similar to goats. As forests develop, we might see cattle with graceful, deer-like forms to run between trees. and to camouflage to avoid detection. Perhaps some swamp-like regions would develop as well, leading to small cattle with spread hooves to not sink in the mud. I'll likely go into more detail on desert cattle and other such species in a future episode, once Apollo's climate is more severe. For smaller species, defense strategies would have to be different. Herding, for example, might not be as useful below a certain size. Many goat or baboon-sized cows might get benefit from living in groups, but once they're small enough, they might get more benefit from simply scattering when a predator shows itself. Herding can distract carnivores, leading them to eat others instead of you, or be good for defense. But if you're bite-sized, the larger carnivore might come along and see your herd as a bag of beef jerky. This isn't to say all strategies a large cattle might use would be for naught in their smaller counterparts. For example, smaller animals are a lot more nimble and hard to chase down, so being fast might be very useful to escape the newly evolved Minnow Vulpus. This would lead to many tiny cattle darting into the brush at the first signs of danger. Perhaps some would develop a meerkat-like strategy, where one individual stands guard and alerts the others if threats arrive. In turn, most Minnow Vulpids would adapt to be ambush hunters, trying to catch their prey before it can run. They'd likely strengthen their jaws to hold on to prey, adapting to jump or sprint out of hiding, with camouflage to avoid detection. Climbing and burrowing are obvious methods of avoiding predators, although Minnow Vulpus would likely follow its prey by adapting to also climb or getting thin and mustelid-like to enter burrows. But a more difficult strategy to counter would be spines. Perhaps some tiny cattle develop thick, sharpened fur that they can use like a porcupine or hedgehog. These quills might be short in the forest for navigating brush, and longer out in the plains, but they both provide some measure of protection from carnivores trying to bite or trample them. But despite all the porcupine's defenses, they're still prey to plenty of animals. Whatever defenses herbivores evolve, something's probably going to find ways to bypass them. Carnivorous cattle might flip their spiny prey, or use their hooves to avoid getting pricked. Almost nothing would be truly safe. A case of predators following their prey that I mentioned early on was aquatic cattle, with Tauropotamus quickly taking to the seas to eat masses of plankton, and Minophilus often following. In the Hyacinthus Sea, Apollo's largest ocean, whale-like filter feeders would likely evolve, perhaps spurring large orca or mosasaur-like cattle to hunt them. But let's leave that for a future episode on Apollo's bodies of water. Thanks for watching! Please like and subscribe if you've enjoyed the video, and leave a comment if you have any thoughts. Speaking of which, I asked the comments from the last video to name several of the groups of flying cattle. But first, it's worth mentioning that, as many people pointed out, mammals lack a lot of the adaptations that birds and pterosaurs have that allow them to get so big. So it's possible these flying cattle couldn't get much larger than a flying fox. Although, with enough time and a lack of competition, they might push past this barrier. Anyway, on to the names. I'll be calling the clade of ancestral flying cows Paleopterotaura, meaning old flying cows. All true flying cattle will be part of the group Pterotauria, with the earliest flying carnivores named Carnotaurus. And finally, the clade of large flying cattle, should it exist, will be Dracotaurus, or dragon cow. Thank you for all your awesome suggestions. Another issue raised in the last video was the time frame of 5 to 7 million years for flight to evolve from cattle, and after some thinking, I agree that this is probably too short of a time for such dramatic adaptations. I imagine 10 to 30 million years would be a better estimate for some of these big changes, although I'm not an expert in deep time, so currently there's no hard set timeline for Project Apollo. And evolution can happen very quickly when given the opportunity, which a Seedworld's many available niches would definitely provide. Sorry about the mix-up. Also, consider checking out my Patreon if you're in a position to do so, although there's not a lot of content on there at the moment, and watching these videos is certainly enough. You can also find the full images of most of Apollo's cattle on there for free. Sorry about the lack of content recently, I've been lacking motivation or inspiration for this channel. I'm considering videos treading on different ground, like xenobiology on a high-gravity world, or a fantasy world-building project. Monster Garden's inspiring me. Maybe check out some more videos on my channel, apparently YouTube's algorithm likes that. Anyway, thanks for watching, have a great day, and I'll see you next time!